gardeners, welcome back to another video on my channel. My name is Trisha, and in today's video we're going to be talking all about the crested gecko diet. So I'm very excited to do this video because lately I've been getting a ton of questions, and it seems like it is very common for people to get crested geckos at pet stores and the pet stores give them false information regarding their diet. And then basically the gecko is just off to a really bad start and people just don't have the correct information to give them the proper diet. So I just wanted to make a video that way there's a nice reference out there for people to find in case they want to feed their gecko a proper diet and realize that maybe they're doing something wrong. And for those of you that already know all of this, I'm so sorry for the recap. Maybe you'll learn something new, but I hope that you guys enjoy the video and I appreciate you guys being here. So thank you so much. So when it comes to crested gecko diets, usually in the wild, they eat a lot of fruit combinations and they eat insects as well. So both are very important in their diet and have a lot of nutritional value. So one of the mistakes that I've seen with crested gecko owners is some of the time, it's not as common anymore, but in the past, a lot of the time people would just feed their crested geckos fruits that they have at their house, or they would give them baby food because baby food has fruit in it. So I understand the thought process, but unfortunately with a diet like that, the crested gecko is still losing out on a ton of nutrients that it requires in its diet. The good thing about this is that there was a product created that basically just has all the nutritional value in one for crested geckos, and that is either Pangea or Repashy. There are a couple of other different brands as well, but those are the most popular ones that are used. I personally use Pangea most of the time with my geckos. And there are different flavors. There's so many different varieties that includes all of these different fruits. And it's really good because it has everything that that gecko needs in that diet. That way it's not missing out on any nutrients. However, if you do want to feed your gecko some fruit, you can do that, but it is more of like a snack for them. And you do wanna make sure that you're getting them a crested gecko formula all in one, like the Pangea or the Repashy, to make sure that they're not missing out on any nutrients. Some people like to make their geckos little smoothies, which is totally fine as a snack. You just don't wanna have that as a staple because again, it'll be missing out on nutrients. So when it comes to some of the fruits for crested geckos that they can have, if you would like to create a little smoothie snack for them or just give them a little treat every now and then, are blueberries, figs, kiwi, mango, cantaloupe, raspberry, banana, and there are other options as well, but those are just some of the most common ones. So if there's something that you want to try with your gecko, make sure that you just look it up online, Google it really quick to make sure it's safe for your gecko before feeding it to them. The other most important part to their diet is insects. So a lot of the time, they may prefer this, especially the babies, because insects are where they're gonna get the protein in order to grow. So if you have a crested gecko that's on the smaller side that you wanna beef up some more, you should definitely give them more protein and insects. Sometimes geckos may favor the insects over the Pangea or Repashy, and that's a seasonal change that just occurs naturally in the wild because some fruits may be in season where the crested geckos are and they fall down at certain times, and other times there aren't as many and that's when they go for the insects. And so in captivity, it's kind of interesting because some of the crested geckos still go off of that system and they may prefer insects over the Pangea for a little bit or trade off. Or you may just have a picky eater, and I'm gonna talk more about that in the end and give you guys some tips and tricks on that. So when you're feeding insects, some of the good options to feed as a staple are dubia roaches, crickets, hornworms, silkworms, and waxworms on occasion because they can be very fattening. I get asked all the time if you can feed mealworms to crested geckos, and I wouldn't recommend it just because their exoskeletons are so hard to break down. They have been known to cause issues for other reptiles, so I think that it's better to just be safe and not offer them to crested geckos. That's my personal opinion, and that's what I do with my geckos as well. Another thing regarding the insects is that you do want to make sure that it is coming from a reputable place. A lot of the times, crickets can carry different types of parasites, and you want to avoid that as best you can by just getting from reputable places like reptile specific stores that are near you. Josh's Frogs has amazing feeders. There's so many different feeder places that you can get them from online. So you just want to make sure that you're going to be getting good quality for your animals because that is what is going to be going in their body, and you want to make sure you're not giving them anything that could potentially cause them any harm. So the next thing that I want to talk about regarding insects is gut loading. So for those of you that aren't familiar with gut loading, it is when you are feeding your insects healthy foods that They will eat and digest. And then when your gecko goes to eat that insect, it's gonna contain even more nutrition in it and get that in their bodies, which is good for them. But you do wanna make sure that you're gonna be gut loading with things that are, again, safe for crested geckos. So when it comes to gut loading for me, I usually just feed my insects different types of greens and veggies that I'm going to be feeding for my bearded dragon, my tortoise. Any of my basic leftovers that I'm using to create their salads is what I hand over to my insects. So this is a great way to get some veggies in your crested gecko as well, and some greens and just way more nutrients. So some of the safe options to use for this are escarole, dandelion greens, collard greens, butternut squash, carrot, zucchini, and hibiscus flower. So regarding hibiscus flower, you do want to make sure that it does not have any pesticides on it. If you just picked it from somewhere or you bought it from a store, you got to be very careful with that, because if it has any pesticides or chemicals on it and then the insect eats it and then your gecko eats it, they could get very sick, and you want to avoid that at all costs. However, hibiscus can be a healthy option for added nutrition if you do it properly, so that's why I wanted to add it in this video. There are also insect feeders that you can buy at reptile stores or Petco or PetSmart that you specifically feed to the crickets in order to give them more nutrients. And you can do that as well. I find that what works best for me is just feeding them veggies. I feel like that's the most healthy thing that you could possibly do, and it's the most natural as well. So that is what I choose to do. You guys can totally just do whatever you want to do. I'm just saying what I do because a lot of people are interested in what I do with my animals. The next thing I want to talk about regarding their diet is supplementation, because this is something that sometimes is forgotten or not fully understood correctly, and therefore their animals are not getting properly supplemented, and it is a very, very important part of their diet to make sure that they do not get sick. So if you are keeping a crested gecko without any UVB whatsoever, it is important to give them calcium with D3 because they need that in order to synthesize their calcium. Without this, they can get metabolic bone disease and get very, very sick and suffer and die, and you absolutely don't want that to happen. That is why supplementation is so important. So it can get a little bit confusing because some people like to offer their crested geckos UVB within their enclosures. So if you're going to be doing this, you also don't want to overdo the D3 as well, because you can overdo it. It has to be a healthy medium, and that can be kind of hard to decipher with crested geckos because some of them will actually bask under the UVB and get that D3 from the UVB, whereas others will hide away from that UVB and not get as much exposure. So this is where it can get pretty confusing, and every case is going to be a little bit different. So if your gecko is a really good basker, it's always under that UVB getting full spectrum lighting, then I would use calcium without D3. If you have a crested gecko that is getting some of the UVB but is mainly hidden away during the day and isn't getting much exposure, then you would want to make sure that you're going to be giving calcium with D3 to make sure it's in their diet. If you're using a UVB and you just aren't sure, it might be good just to trade off between calcium with D3 and without D3, just to make sure it's a healthy medium and you're not going to be overdoing it or not giving them enough D3 in their diet. The other thing regarding supplementation is the multivitamin. So multivitamins are very important to give them extra vitamins in their diet, as it sounds, because it's called a multivitamin. So when it comes to multivitamins, usually what I do is I pick one day out of the month, and instead of using calcium, I dust my insects with the multivitamin instead and feed them that. You can do this more frequently. Some people do it like maybe once every 2 weeks, so twice a month. You can do that as well. So there's not really a specific amount of usage or instruction for it, so that's where it can get a little confusing. But for me, I just choose one day of the month, and that is the multivitamin day for everyone. When it comes to offering these supplementations, what I do is I dust them on my insects. So anytime I'm gonna be feeding insects to my geckos, that's when they're gonna be getting either the calcium with D3 or the multivitamin. The last thing regarding supplementation is not a requirement, but it's something that I thought I would add because it is just more minerals and nutrients in their diet, and that is bee pollen. So if you wanna use bee pollen, you wanna make sure that it's organic. You can get it from many different places and it comes in different forms. The best form for it to be in is a powder form. And if you're gonna get it like this, you can just mix it right into their Pangea and then they'll eat it, and it's perfect. It'll just add some more nutrients into their diet and minerals, and there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. Next, regarding diet, I want to talk about how often should they eat. So this is another thing that's a little controversial, and sometimes people don't like how I do it, and I don't know, what I've been doing works for my animals. They're all a healthy weight, so I like to stick to feeding my geckos every 3 days. I switch off every 3 days between Pangea and insects, and that has been working great for my geckos the entire time I've had them, which is like, how many years now? Maybe 4 years, 5 years? So yeah, it's been working out great. They're at healthy weights, and that's just the system that I like to do with my geckos. They absolutely don't eat every single day, so I find that this system just works great for them. If you have a baby crested gecko, you can offer food more often. Some people feed them every single day. They may not eat every single day again, so that's just another thing to be aware of. Some people are very worried when they get a baby crested gecko that they aren't eating, and that is the next topic that I'm going to talk about. So if you have a baby crested gecko and you are very worried that it's not eating, the best way to tell if it's eating or not is if there's poop in the enclosure. So if it's pooping, it's definitely eating. So it can get really hard to tell because crested geckos, a lot of the time, they are nocturnal, so they're mainly going to be eating at nighttime, and some of them are very secretive eaters. So they aren't going to want to eat when you're just standing there watching them, and they certainly aren't going to eat if you're trying to feed them during the day. So those are things to be aware of. And another thing to be aware of is that because you're going to be feeding them the fruit mix of Pangea or Rapashi, sometimes they'll eat some of it and you can't tell the difference because they'll eat such a small amount, especially the babies, because they don't eat as much. They may eat such a tiny amount that it's hard to tell that they've even eaten at all when really they have. So as they get older and they start eating more and more, you'll be able to see a more significant difference. So as long as they're pooping, I wouldn't be too concerned. They're absolutely eating something if they're pooping. The next thing I want to talk about is picky eaters. So as I mentioned earlier, there are seasonal changes in New Caledonia. So crested geckos may prefer the fruit over the insect for a certain portion of the time and then switch back. That happens in captivity as well. Or you may just have a picky eater. So this can get a little stressful because a lot of the times crested geckos will choose the insects over the Pangea or the Rapashi. And a lot of the times this happens because people sell the crested geckos at pet stores only feeding them insects, telling the people that they only need insects in their diet. And then when you bring them home and find out they actually need the Pangea or Rapashi to get all of the nutrients in their diet, they don't want it because they're used to eating the insects. So what to do when this happens? So the best thing that you can do if your gecko just straight up does not want the Pangea or Rapashi is you can try hand feeding. What I do for this is use a little spoon, put some Pangea on it, bring it up to your gecko's face, just nudge it on their face a little bit so they get a tiny little bit of Pangea on their mouth. And then by licking it off, they're gonna get some Pangea in their bodies and get some nutrients. A lot of the times they'll get used to this and they may just start licking it off of the spoon more and more and they just wanna eat it from you. So that is an option. Over time, you may be worried that, oh no, they're only gonna wanna hand feed for the rest of their life. That absolutely doesn't happen. I used to hand feed all of my hatchlings and then over time they just eat on their own. So that has never been an issue. Another thing that you can try if your gecko flat out just refuses to hand feed is you can just dip your insects into the Pangea and then offer it to your gecko, because by doing this, they're gonna have the Pangea or the Rapashi all over the bug. They're gonna get it in their system. They're gonna get some nutrients and they'll start to familiarize themselves with that flavor and taste as well and learn that it's food and then hopefully start eating it on their own. And then if you have a picky gecko that is the complete opposite and they prefer the Pangea and Rapashi over the insects and they aren't eating any of the insects in their diet, you can offer them a different type of formula from Pangea. There's a breeding formula, or there's the insect Pangea as well that has insects in it. That way they can get that protein in their bodies. So that is a great way to get it in their system by tricking them. So I hope that this video was helpful. Thank you guys so much for watching. If you guys have any other tips and tricks regarding picky eaters or anything regarding crested gecko diets, please go ahead and leave it in a comment. I really appreciate when you guys add to the video. So thank you so much. And thank you guys so much for just being here. I hope that you have an amazing day and I will see you guys in the next video.